question I have for you other questions are taken up. One question is generally Ishvara Pranidhana is considered to be something like one need not do anything. But I think from your talk, I could understand that it is an active participation to let go. Because Ishvara Pranidhana, surrender, sometimes it is translated as surrender to the will of God, which seems to appear as though I am absolving myself of all responsibility and guilt. So I think my question would be, can you just throw some more light on it and tell us how it is a very active principle in the whole system as such? Sure. That's the reason why it's called as Kriya Yoga, I think.
Yeah. Thank you for this wonderful question. I'm sure you would have definitely something small to add after I have shared. Whether we look into this part in Patanjali's Yoga Sutra or even in Bhagavad Gita, when Krishna is speaking about various levels of offerings that one can make, he just goes on offering various, you might call so as a concessions. He says, see if you can offer every act of yours to this divine will. Or if you think you can't do that, at least you just offer the fruits of the outcome and the fruits of action that have emerged. You offer that. Even if you can't offer this, you can do this. If you think even this is difficult, then you can see, you can do this. So he goes on giving you various options. But in all these options, what is common is an active involvement in this offering. It's not something I throw up my hands and say, no, it's I can't do it anymore, or it's not my responsibility. But as Krishna Paniji rightly pointed out, this is an act of responsibility where I realize that even there is a larger force, larger intellect, which is operating around me, which is operating through me. So I realize this and allow myself that possibility of receiving it and also expressing it. Sometimes I look into things by own my limited nature. And I might even miss something that is obvious in front of me. But when I'm capable of receiving this grace, when I make this as a voluntary or not just voluntary, a very a determined act, then it's quite possible for that greater intellect to operate through me. So this knowing that there is a higher agency coming out of the limited perceptive framework with which I normally operate and engage, I think that is the that is the call here. There, as again rightly pointed, this is a Kriya Yoga. It's actually a doing something, not refraining from doing or escaping from doing. So it's that kind of offering, an active doing of something. Yeah.
Kanchan, you want to ask something?
Thank you.
Thank you, Vinayji, for this wonderful presentation. My question is not specifically related to Kriya Yoga as such, but the word transformation, which I find very intriguing. So I feel how yoga views transformation as such. Transformation, does it indicate, going from X to Y? Is there a path to transformation? Is it a destination or it is internal, a change, which is what we call generally spiritual transformation, inner transformation. So how does yoga view transformation in general?
Of course, this problem of translation that comes always. Any word that we have to translate or any concept that we need to translate, we use the framework or the words from the other language, which might come from a completely different cultural background. While we try to transcend, again, translate, transcend, transform. So while we try to transcend the limitations of the language barriers, yet if the meaning of the transformation is seen as a change that is happening from A to B, then that is not what we intend here. What we intend here, which is again brought about by many Vedantic texts, is that whatever we are, it seems to be covered by many layers. So this uncovering, uncluttering, in Patanjali's own words, when he says, yoga chitta vritti nirodha, the slowing down of the vrittis, that is nothing but uncluttering or reducing the number of vrittis. And then he says, tada drashtu swarupe avasthanam, this swarupa avasthana, this rediscovering of the swarupa, one's own inherent nature. In fact, to refer to that, we use the word transformation, which will give a tendency or which will give an impression that there is a movement or there is relocating oneself from point A to point B. While in the actual sense, it's just wherever we are, whatever the position, there seems to be a lot of layers and layers of covering that are there. So we uncover ourselves and make ourselves those transparent beings where the light can emerge out of it. So that regaining of that swarupa, in fact, that these are the two beautiful words if we have to use the Yoga Sutra itself, swarupa avasthana and sarupya. Swarupa and sarupya. Swarupa is essential form, sarupya is identical form. So from the identical form where we have identified with everything else, we need to move back to our essential form. So that is what we can call as transformation in this context.
I just have a question.
Yes, hope this answers, or you have any other question?
Yeah, yes, that's perfectly answered. So which is the Sanskrit word which is closest to, Sanskrit, no, whatever, Indic word which is closest to transformation?
The swarupa prapti. So to get that swarupa or to regain that swarupa is that word, that's it. And the other, the conditional existence is sarupya. The essential existence is swarupa. And they have been brought in the right in the third and the fourth sutras.
Okay, I just have a question.
Yes.
Regarding that point where you said, why are we looking for transformation? Why can't we be the way we are? See, each person is unique and has their own individual personality. And each, all collectively put together, is what brings the complete networking of this whole universe. So there is some plus, there is some minus, so everything gets neutralized. So if everyone gets into this positive frame of work, will the diversity be neutralized, and can it cause some sort of a issue in the whole universe?
Well, while it is a very good question, but fortunately or unfortunately, that ideal situation will not come. In fact, Patanjali himself, he takes up this question somewhere in the second chapter. He says, avidya can be lost with respect to one person, but be assured it will continue for other people. So that's why it is samsara. There are various levels. It's just like the relay race that all of us are running. For an onlooker who joins the scene a little later, they don't even know, or they can't even identify which one is running in which level. Maybe the person in the first track might be just in the first round. The second one might already be running in the second track. So they might you might see them on the same line, but they might be running their own rounds. So we don't even know where it is going, which way, and it keeps on going like this. So it might be lost with respect to one person, but to the others it will continue. However, we also see this in a cyclic manner. There is not just the cyclic, the time is not seen in a cyclic manner, but rather in a spiral manner. While collectively also there is some changes that are happening. Collectively, we find times where we are more focused. There are times collectively we are more away from the central alignment. So even that kind of movement also happens where there's ups and downs at a collective level. But at individual level, for sure, we are on our own unique tracks, and it will continue to remain so for quite a bit of time. That's why it's samsara running in the loops.
Thanks.
So there is no fear of monoculture or mono nature. The diversity will be safeguarded.
Dr. Vinay Chandra, what I think is, Premji, see, if the beauty of it is, it opens a wide vistas and a channel, you know. In the sense, if it is possible for one, it's possible for everybody. So that is the idea of, if one person can truly come out of that avidya, it opens a channel for the whole humanity. So it is a great inspiration and motivates us to move in that direction because somebody has already opened the channel.
In fact, if I can add a little more to what Krishna Paniji just said, if we look into the Rigvedic literature, you come across various stories where a cave is involved. So there is cave. The Panis have stolen the cows. They have kept them in the darkness. So Indra goes there or someone goes there. There is a battle that happens and they release the cows. The word for cow is go, and go also means light. Cave is an area of darkness, which points to this fact that each one of us carry the darknesses in our own unique ways. The pattern that I carry is completely unique to myself, while the pattern that the other person, or the set of patterns, the bundles of patterns that they carry, is unique. So while I'm helping myself, I'm also contributing towards this pattern wherever it exists universally. Right? So that's why you can find many, many references to the stories of the Panis, but each one is a unique story there. Each one is different. Each Rishi tries to bring out his own cave experience and the liberation of the light that happens in this cave, which is nothing but this spiritual journey, where a part of it is liberated, but yet the other parts continue. But collectively also it has offered something at that point.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
So can we say that the sutras are actually giving us some sort of formula for us to process this particular Kriya Yoga through the practices of tapas and svadhyaya and Ishvara Pranidhana, so that there is a universal formula that each one of us can follow, but the quality and the characteristics and the traits are individualistic? Is that how we can put it?
Yes, definitely you can say so. One thing is...
So the thing is, we don't even know anything about ourselves, but we are clouded by all sorts of conditioning. And therefore, that becomes a sense of apathy, and we move towards awareness, being within ourselves. So it's not like moving, like you said, not from moving from point A to point B, but even that point A to point B is within ourselves. It's in the essential existence of our own self.
Yes, you may definitely say so. What Yoga Sutra is trying to do is to point towards the deeper psychological aspects of human phenomenon. What in modern terms we call it as depth psychology, which was popularized with the approach of Freud. So in fact, Yoga Sutra in this part, I didn't go to a couple of sutras there, but when he says about the kleshas and then says, prasupta tanu vichinna udarana, what are the modes and levels in which each one of these kleshas operate? He says they operate at four different levels. And when he's speaking about prasupta and vichinna, he's actually referring to the subconscious and the unconscious levels of its operation. So not just the conscious level, but also the other levels. So this is one of the first reference to depth psychology per se that you can come across. Having grasped that, what he tries to do is to equip us with simple tools and define the broader contours of the tools, not going to the specifics. This is the beauty of the Indian tradition, which I admire so much, that it recognizes that each one is unique. What is tapas for me need not be or will not be tapas for the other. But how should tapas be brought about? The guidelines will be provided. But what exactly works for you, you decide for yourself. right? You choose your tool. If a hammer works for you, that is good. If something else works for you, you choose your tool. I am not here to state that one tool fits for all. No, this is not my approach. This is not the approach of the Indic thought. This is not the approach of the Eastern thought. No one tool fits for all. No one book fits for all. No one way of doing things fits for all. Okay, each one is unique. Each one is healing his own wounds. Each one is running his own loop. Therefore, you need to decide what heals you, what works on you best. And that is why many times I say that what Patanjali offers is a toolbox, not just individual tools. So you make sense of the toolbox, what works on you, to what length, how do you want to go about it, what actually provides you with swadhyaya. Maybe reading a spiritual text might be a swadhyaya for you, but for someone else, just sitting in front of a lake and observing a vast lake or an ocean could be a swadhyaya for them, right? So swadhyaya, whatever allows you to that, for that reflection to happen. And Ishwara Pranidhana, if you feel by going to a temple, you can feel that sense of offering, fine, do it. Or as Krishna says in the Gita, patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhaktya prayachati. Whatever you feel like, either a leaf or a fruit, if you feel like offering, do that. Or elsewhere he says, the jnani, the knowledgeable himself is the greatest bhakta that I have come across. Okay, that is a way, through knowledge you seek it. Or again, if you stand, go to the top of a mountain, and then you see the vast spread in front of you, whereby you can feel that you are nothing, then that's good. Maybe I'll end with this story or this just reference to Ramakrishna Paramahamsa and his disciples, and which also signifies the two different paths of Jnana Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. Okay. So they say that when Mother Prakriti cast her net, two people escaped, it seems, of that net. And how did two people do? One of them, he said, he became so big and so big and so big. He said, I am everything, I am universe. So that was one way of escaping the net. And that was the path of Jnana Yoga, where you enlarge yourself to that extent that everything, including Prakriti, is subsumed into it. So that is one way which Vivekananda did. And there's a reference goes to another householder who was also a true devotee of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. He said, I am nothing, and he became so small that he escaped through the hole of the net. Okay? So that is the path of Bhakti Yoga. Escaping the net is important. How you want to go about it, what works for you is you choose. Whether the Karma Yoga path, that is tapas, whether Jnana Yoga path, that is Swadhyaya, or Bhakti Yoga path, that is Ishwara Pranidhana. Choose your path. Choose your tool. What works best for you is good enough.
Just to continue, because you mentioned Freud, I have just one more question. So can we say that the Sanchita Karma and Prarabdha Karma correlate to the unconscious and the subconscious respectively? Like Sanchita Karma is unconscious and Prarabdha Karma is the subconscious. Because through the subconscious activity is where we continue to gather karma. And I think that becomes prarabdha karma, right?
And yeah, the it's unconscious a topic in itself, but I will hold back from speaking about it. But roughly you can say so, you can make these correspondences while there are unique characters of both the perspectives. Roughly, yeah, you can have this correspondence.
So because these are the tendencies and patterns that we have to overcome.
Sure.
But thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Vinay Chandra. I think it's already 8:22 now. Yes, and we've taken enough of your time. I request Reshmi to conclude the session.
Yes, thank you.
Before Reshmi ji comes in, maybe I'll take this opportunity to thank Ritambhara, Beena ji, Krishnapani ji, Prem ji, and Praveen ji, and Reshmi, for all of you for giving this wonderful opportunity to share and to be one among you, with you in this group. Thank you. Thank you.
It's a privilege to have you on our forum, and we hope you will continue to extend your support and share your vast experience of this particular subject. And we look forward to more interesting sessions as we go about.
Thank you,
Vinayji. Thank you to all our participants for your valuable presence this evening. Please join us for our two upcoming programs. On Sunday, 27th December, we have a program by Umesh Thagath ji, starting from 7 a.m. onwards. It's based on boosting the immunity. And on Tuesday, 29th December, we have a very special program by Ms. Harika Bhagat on healing powers of art. The details will be posted in the WhatsApp groups. Please block your dates for the upcoming webinars. At Tritambara, we look forward to your presence every Friday, where we bring to you interesting topics on holistic wellness and the arts, delivered by a host of distinguished and knowledgeable speakers. Thank you once again for your presence and participation today from all of us at Tritambara. Thank you.
Thank you.